everybody. Welcome to this month's Patreon exclusive Heroclix class. This is your host, Daniel Powell, speaking. This month, we are going to be talking about Vulture Prime, how to battle, how to build, and how to beat. And then the second half of the class, we will be talking about Pogs, how to manage them, how to work around them, and just general tips and strategies with managing a Pog team. If you enjoy this class, please consider subscribing to our Patreon at patreon.com/clickstoff. At the $5 level and higher, you get exclusive access to these classes live and can interact with us if you join us. If not, we can we have our exclusive Patreon Discord channel in which to discuss tactics and strategy and all of that kind of good stuff. So without further ado, let's talk about the big bad meanie that is Vulture Prime. Vulture has won several big events. lately, some WKOs, a qualifier, and with going into nationals, he seems to be kind of the big bad that was lurking there. It was interesting. We had a couple of events this weekend on 5/18 of 19, and there was no Vultures being played, which I found to be interesting. I really think it's a thing where the top-level Heroclix players are holding back a little bit on Vulture and some of their top-tier teams going into Nationals to kind of pad it. I've seen Black Adam win and another Ultra Chase team, and I just don't think that some of those things are really the top tier. I think they're holding out on their Nationals builds and for the big event at Origins. But this video is, our Patreons will be watching this before Nationals, and everyone else, this will go live most likely after Nationals. So if you're listening to it now, it's probably sometime in June when you're watching this. So we'll see if Vulture can win Nats or not. My prediction is that he has a really good chance if some folks pilot him and don't pay attention to how he works and how to crack it. But that's what we plan on going over today. So what I want to do is I want to talk about how the team works. Because oftentimes if you can figure out how a particular team works, you're able to counter that team in a little bit better way. So my first comparison here is going to be versus the standard sort of Hawkeye build. And kind of how that works and how some of the pieces and parts of Vulture really make it effective against these types of builds. So Let's just hop in, excuse me. So, first turn, the Star Fox Hawkeye build, the Giant Girls, we've talked about this in our past videos. The Giant Girls are going to run out. They're going to drop the objects on Star Fox and Hawkeye, and then they're going to maintain their first turn immunity. They might do some other sidesteps within their starting area, that sort of thing. But we know this for sure. So what is Vulture likely to do turn one? For the most part, Vulture is going to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah. So for the most part, Vulture is going to be equipping and bearing turn one. So in this situation, you've got to think about how do you protect Vulture long enough for him to be able to get his flurries off. So the team that I'm using today is a modified one of one I ran at a regional a few weeks ago. So that includes Vulture, the Octopus Arms, the Joker's Gas Canister, three Big Tonys in this example, President Rickard, Mr. Oz, and a Skyscraper Wonder Woman. So a few notes from as we go through this team. Let's just go over turn one to start out with. First of all, you've got four actions to play with because of President Rickard. So what you want to be able to do is make sure that you are protecting Vulture at the end of this turn so Hawkeye can't come over. So the first thing you want to do is you want to get some of your perplexes out of the way. So you want to be able to use Al Jordan's special perplex. So the first thing he's going to do is perplex up attack turn one. So that turn two, he can double perplex up Vulture's attack. So he's going to choose Tiny. He's going to choose Barrier. Skyscraper Wonder Woman is going to walk out. One, two, three, four, five, six. I think she's got six. And pick up the Joker gas. She's then going to be able to sidestep over to here and just still hang on to the gas for the moment. Mr. Oz is going to TK the arms back. Right, make sure I got that line of fire correct. All the way up through here, all the way down. Al Jordan choosing Tiny is key. Equip TK, equip standard stuff. Then you're going to be able to get a token on her. And sorry, you do want to go ahead and let's see how I'm thinking about how I ran this to make sure you do it correctly. You want to be able to perplex up defense here. Sidestep over. He'll sidestep down. He'll perplex up Vulture's defense. This Big Tony will sidestep down. And perplex up. This Big Tony will perplex up probably Mr. Oz's defense. And I did that the wrong way. This Big Tony. A lot of this team is managing this first turn. So what you want to do is just leave that Big Tony there. Sorry. And then, so this is off the board. This is being held. And either way, you can either have the Skyscraper Wonder Woman go get it. And I think for line of fire purposes, probably have to have the Big Tony go get it. Let's take that off of her. Because he has six. He can get back to there. He can sidestep this next turn and drop the gas, which is fine. So the next thing will be to build barrier with Al Jordan. He's holding that little gas. So you build the barrier, and Alex did not leave me any barrier markers. So let me just go ahead and do this way. And we'll just have Isaac's be our barrier markers. So this is leads me to my first point as we go into the second turn for Hawkeye. the ability for Mr. Oz to stop TK is just entirely too powerful, I think. So, in typical fashion, Star Fox will pick sidestep. He'll call out Jean Grey to hear. And then he'll want to, or hear, whatever. And he'll want to TK up Star Fox or Hawkeye for free after they do all their perplexes and giant girls move up and do all this other stuff. But as soon as they do that Hawkeye free TK up, he moves back to. Then they'll TK him up 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You move him back 2. So now he has a running shot of 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, he is able to get to Skyscraper Wonder Woman and potentially Big Tony, which in this case are potentially acceptable losses, but he then has no line of fire to get off onto anything else. You know, his potential line of fire would have to be all the way up here, which, as you can see, he doesn't have enough reach, enough movement to get to this back square, this back line, or far enough up on that line of the map. So even if you do lose a Big Tony this way, or Skyscraper Wonder Woman, you now have a Hawkeye to munch to build up charges to get to this side of the map. Or you just eat this side of the map and go from there. So typically Hawkeye is going to try to barrier, which is pretty hard on one of these type of maps. And even if they do effectively barrier, the giant reach and that sort of thing, they just have to make it really slows down their tempo. I haven't really found a very effective strategy for being able to barrier on the typical Hawkeye maps. So Hawkeye is one of those things where he pretty much just gets boned by this team. So the turn two, if they barrier, what you're going to now do is you can roll for President Rickard's leadership, right? And this is what's neat, is that that can remove it from Hawkeye, assuming that there's an opposing character over here on this side of the map to have a token, which it should, considering they should barrier that turn. If not, you know what? You're just going to have to push Vulture, which is not a huge deal. So what you want to be able to do at this point is the Big Tony will sidestep down to here. He'll drop the Joker gas into Al Jordan Square. Al Jordan's going to take, you know, you're going to perplex up, attack by 2. You can perplex up movement by 1 from this Big Tony, movement by 1 with that Big Tony. You can then sidestep. The Joker gas is here. You're then going to use your first action on Al to bust the gas and bathe Vulture with the gas. So at that point, Al Jordan probably chooses Giant and chooses Giant and chooses Shape Change or just something defensively. He'll sidestep 1, 2, Big thing is make sure that he doesn't block line of fire. Carrying the big Tony. So this one has perplexed. This one has perplexed. All good. So this big Tony will sidestep down. He'll either go into attack or movement. Doesn't really, I'm sorry, not attack, but damage or movement. Again, in the Hawkeye matchup, it doesn't really matter because you don't need the 6 damage typically. But what you'll then do is then you'll take your second action. You'll TK with Mr. Oz. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. He goes to here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Sorry, he'll go to there, right there on that direct diagonal. Mr. Oz places him 1, 2. So now, Vulture can go 1, 2. And then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And then he has the giant reach to reach that first giant girl. Or these giant girls over here. but most importantly, you still got to do one last thing. That sidestep over with Skyscraper Wonder Woman. And then move her up, carrying Mr. Oz to here. So that you can get his magnificent 12 range prob. So that will cover pretty much the whole map. So that's why I chose a sidestepping colossal. If there was a sidestepping giant or something that I could use that carried flyers, all of that would be an option for me as well. It just comes down to Mr. Oz flies, so I couldn't use something like an Ironheart or any something along those lines to do it. So, Vulture's now going to... And see, and the other thing here is that this Vulture has the reach with Mr. Oz that he doesn't have to potentially roll for his second sidestep to get the reach. Mr. Oz essentially gives him that reach. So now we'll go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And we can go to any of these things. So your first flurry, you're going to attempt to build up 2 flurries, killing those giant girls. Then you'll have a flurry banked. They'll most likely try to use most of their theme team probability controls, which makes sense. This first attack is going to be a 14 on a 19 here, so you do have to roll a 5. This one's going to be a 4, so pretty low numbers, but you still do need Mr. Oz's prob. In this example where you don't hit the leadership, you're going to have to immediately then push Vulture, which makes him go down to 13 for 6 or 13 for 5. So ignoring characters in flight, he's then going to try to come over here. Well, not try. He'll use one of his banked flurries to kill Eric Masterson, needing a 3. Then trying to kill Vulture, Captain America. That allows him to have 2, 3 banked charges. He can then go and use a charge here, taking him down. So he banked up 2 here. He went to 1 to go to here. He banked up 2, 3 charges, sorry. And then he'll go down to 2 charges here, KOing a giant girl, taking him up to 3 charges. Then he'll go down to 4 charges. If he goes to 6 damage, he can KO Hawkeye outright. And then he can go kill these 2 giant girls here. And then the remainder of his flurries go into Star Fox, which will most likely be a 20 defense. So you know, it's pretty much a turn two situation where he has enough flurries built up to be able to pretty much just he doesn't need prob because he's going to flurry that many times. I had a matchup where I actually crit missed twice, and I got down to the click four in the Hawkeye matchup. Now I was, you know, I was still 13 attack. I was at 5 damage. But the main thing is that it doesn't require him to have charge, because whenever Vulture KOs a character after resolutions, he can use charge at no cost is the important part there. So he gains charge back even if he loses it off of his dial. So the crit miss damage happens immediately, but he can still continue to use banked up charges and wipe out the teams. So, I mean, there was many matches that I had that was turn two. Turn two, they were completely over. And, you know, it was not a bad situation. Most of them was rolling fours, rolling fives. You know, but this is pretty much what Vulture's going to do. And then in matches where Vulture dies and I can't kill the whole squad, then, you know, there's still Al Jordan, 3 perplexes, a Mr. Oz, a retaliating Wonder Woman, and Prez Rickard, you know, who can call out and keep your team going with leadership and all that good jazz. So he does, you know, the team's got other backups, so it's not relying on Vulture. You know, Vulture's only 60 points, but the rest of the team pretty much takes down Vulture pretty handily. Or can function, I'm sorry, let me correct that, can function without Vulture pretty well. So there's, you know, a lot of that leads up to this main question that we have for the class today. What can we do to stop Vulture? What slows down Vulture? You know, what reliably gets through his barrier? What reliably is going to be good against him? So there's a couple of thoughts that I have here. And we've talked a little bit about this on Hawkeye class, but let's talk about it here. I'm going to grab a couple of pieces here. You know, if your team is reliant, and this is really good advice for Nationals, I think, because the Joker's gas canister is going away. So let's talk about the Joker's gas canister first. It's one of those things, I don't know how many times I have to sing it from the top of my lungs, per se, is go shoot the object, folks. Go shoot the object. And in this case, I'm talking about going and shooting the Joker's gas canister. Even in this case of Mr. Oz, now, Uni Lockjaw is not going to particularly play this map. But even in the Mr. Oz case, 1, 2, 3, 4, let's assume that you go out 6, back 2. Uni can go to a 13 range. Which is plenty on any map to shoot the Joker's gas canister. That's going to allow you to have a reliable shape change. Vulture hates rollouts. Now, he mitigates a lot of those with the Battle Fury. There's also different versions of this Vulture build that might include the Tradecraft Phil Coulson so that he can, the 009, so that he can use a standard attack power for precision strike to get around super senses and imperv. Now, I don't realize it doesn't get around imperv, but it certainly helps pink through that damage. So those are things that you've got to start mitigating by allowing Vulture to not be able to have those bypasses. in the Battle Fury, in the Precision Strike. Now, my build didn't have that. It relied more just on the raw stats and the Battle Fury. But the matches that I did lose, I lost to Full Uni. Full Uni won map. Again, Vulture's not a theme team. But Full Uni ran out just by himself and shot my object. Picked Running Shot, picked up his Mandarin Ring on the way, and then shot my Battle Fury. Shot the Joker's gas. So, my first flurry that I went on to him, he had shape change at that point, and I was able to, he was able to just roll out. My first flurry attempt, he shape changed out of it on top dial. Pretty much went downhill from there. Not a whole lot I could have done. So, you know, that's kind of the first advice is, you know, use your team. That mystical team that I played, right? Call out Cyclops. It costs you 3 points, but you shoot the gas canister. He loses some of his stats. He loses the Battle Fury. You know, and if they're playing with the Tradecraft Coulson, you know, maybe he's your first target on that team as opposed to Vulture. Second note that I have here, and this is not a popular note. Stop playing teams with so much reliance on retaliators. Even without the Ock arms, Vulture kills 50 points, 60 points. 50, 65. Look at all, there's all of these squishy figures. Vulture can KO this entire team, assuming he doesn't miss with a 14-13 attack, with just him by himself, right? Because of his trait. So it's one of those things, it's, you know, we've built up this reliance on these glass cannon, retaliator heavy teams. I've talked to different things about, Tyler's monster team, where it's got the two Giganto and Namors, the mini Shredder, and all of the retail. You know, if Tyler's not able to get through that barrier turn one, you know, the Vulture just goes and runs through his team. Because Vulture ignores characters, he goes straight through all of those. He flies through all of those different plasticity characters. But, you know, it comes down to those things. Like, Tyler's team is built to, you know, slow people down with that. And if something can get through it to that back line, then, you know, it's... Even without the Ock arms, he can get into a play where, you know, he just eats through all of these figures, builds up charges, and then chews through the rest of them. And then the rest of the team is able to attack and go from there. So, you know, that's point number two. Beware. Don't make your team so squishy, you know. If Vulture, and I made a list, I have a list out here of different things, you know, what kind of teams are good against Vulture, and keep in mind, these things turn out to be, I want them to be good against the field and good against Vulture. So there's the barrier team that I talked about on last month's episode, right? No retail, hard barrier every turn. Vulture has a huge problem getting through barrier. Now, what I think is funny about that as a side note is old rules flurry. This is pre-2017. Flurry allowed you to break a wall. And then he could get in. So thankfully, new rules barrier, you can't flurry a wall and then get down and break in out, get in and then make an attack. So the hard barrier teams without the colossals, so not the tri-sentinel versions that I've seen play that use hedge map and that sort of thing, those are pretty squishy as well. The uni lockjaw, and this, so what's important about this is that uni lockjaw can't be reliant on a bunch of retaliators, so no floras, only one Groot probably. Let me see if I can find my Groot in here. Only one Groot. But in like your typical starting area, let me just go ahead and pop out the other map here. Let me do that real quick. So you pop out the other map, and you look at a standard starting area. Sorry for the radio silence. Let me get this stretched out. We go. So, in a situation where you have a Uni Lockjaw type team, and Uni and Lockjaw are here, and Groot, the Flora's Groot, stays over here. Now, he can go to here, flurry, and then come down here and then flurry Uni Mind. That's totally a possibility. But one built up flurry is not going to kill Uni. It'll only take him to a stop click. Lockjaw is fine as well. Now, the other note here, and I thought that this one was pretty straightforward, but I played against two different players in a regional against Vulture, and they played Groot, and they both produced Walking Woods and didn't shoot my object. If you have a Groot, singular Groot, do not give them the Walking Woods, or do not give them the Leslie to have the Walking Woods. The Walking Woods, he needs not a crit miss to get them, and he can build, he'll bypass their battle, he'll bypass their shape change with the Joker's gas. And then you just build up the two flurries. You build up a flurry killing one, build up a flurry killing the other, and then you go to town. That seems like straightforward advice that we've talked about before, but the other note, now my version that I had played Prez Rickard, but if they play a Groot and give you a Leslie Evans Pog, keep the le if you get to go first, if you get to go first, it's kind of straightforward. Move the Leslie within your starting area, and then turn two. Move the Leslie again and KO it so that they don't have, you don't lose any points that away, but then you're able to keep them from being able to eat that Leslie and gain a charge. But if you go second for some reason, like you have a low theme, it's only two or three or four, and they are able to go first and give you a Leslie. Your turn one, you have got to move that Leslie away from your retal. If that means you've got to perplex up Leslie Evans' movement, you want to just make sure that they are not able to flurry. So if this was Leslie and this was any other random character, you want to make sure that he cannot giant reach. Attack two characters with a flurry, so that are squishy, that are squishy that die to a single attack. And we've talked, we talked a lot of different about different things. And this goes down to figures that don't with to can't you need to play figures that don't die to a single large attack. Now, the concept of a single large attack is not new, okay? And it's even more recent in the meta. This is, the Alpha Strike or whatever you want to call it. But X-Men Blackbird teams, X-Men Swarm teams have been sending out huge 14 attack, 6 damage, Psy Blast, Precision Strike, Force Blast equipped Cyclopses for a whole year. Uni and Lockjaw perplex up Jean Grey and Cyclopses to the moon, right? Wolverine, for that example, same example. Wolverine's had 13 attack, 6 damage flurries for a long time. Now, I get that the buildup of the charges is the problem, but the fact that Vulture can go 13 for 6 or 14 for 6 should not be an unexpected situation. There, high stat clicks has been a thing since Nighthawk Prime retired. So if you can't withstand a 14 for 6 flurry on a single figure, then that's a problem. Because Wolverine's ready to pop out and do that to you anytime. And let's even just take the attack value out of it. Let's just take the charge flurry blades, right? They can roll 6 on blades. Let's just assume that happens, right? Does your figure die to that? Well, then that's a problem. You got to assume that that Wolverine ID is coming out. Now, Vulture can do it on the map. So, point being, if they get you a Leslie and you go first, and you go second, sorry, make sure that Leslie stays away from the rest of your figures. If that's in this case of Uni Lockjaw, now I know I'm showing a water map here, but let's assume that this was a clear map. Leslie needs to move his butt away. If they put him right next to the other guys, which they probably should, move Leslie away. Move Unimind, carry the Borker away. Move Groot away. Perplex up Groot's movement if you have to. Get his booty out of town. Make it to where they're not banking multiple charges on a single flurry. That's a positioning thing. That's going to come down to what team you want to play, how it looks on the map, and what it looks like from there. So the other thing to talk about, is just stealing the Ock arms. Now, this goes into a two-part situation. Your team just cannot be killed by charges, sans flurry. Now, if your theme team needs to be able to withstand the flurry, or can't withstand the flurry, but it can withstand charges, then stealing the Ock arms is probably a good idea for you. You put this here. He TKs out 4 because we're going to go out 6. We're going to go back 2. The Ock arms have to go out 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then that means you're right there with 11. To be able to triple perplex range. And this is just on a team. This obviously Uni Lockjaw can't do that specifically. But you call out a Jean Grey, you triple perplex her range. She can then steal your object. She's going to be able to swing out that huge range, pull the Awk Arms back so that they can't get it. Now, you've gone down 3 points to zero in the early game, but you've got to have a plan for beyond that. Now, can they barrier every turn? Prez Rickard's version possibly can by removing tokens from Al Jordan. But now this comes into a situation where, well, you can probably pick off soft targets. You can get that back from their retail, whether that's a Skyscraper or a Groot. You start pinging Big Tonys, right? Know the dial. Study, right? Dials on the back of the card are great, but a lot of competitive clicks still comes down to studying. Three clicks, right? You trade another 3 points from a Cyclops to blast a Big Tony. Same thing. You call out, you know, and then at that point when the retail's gone and the some of the other stuff's gone, then you just start pinging away with your figures on the map and attacking with them like you're supposed to be able to. Kill Vulture, kill Al Jordan, go from there. You can pretty much wipe up from there. Because they'll have to get aggressive and start trying to get points back. And then you can be able to outrange them. So, at that point, you know, it comes down to just a regular match. But what you do within your team build, your construction, your force construction in those first critical few turns is going to determine your success against Vulture. My attendance at Nationals this year is up for debate. I don't know with my son coming, if you're watching this before Nationals on the Patreon channel. If you're watching it after Nationals, I guess we'll find out whether or not I went. I would most definitely not play a retail heavy team at Nationals. You'll just get eat by Vulture. You know, Vulture's going to set behind here, 21 defense, set behind barrier with a 21 defense. And my advice would be if you're going to play a retail heavy team, you've got to be able to get behind barrier, turn two, and hit a 21 and blast him off the planet. Now, do I think that maybe the soldier team can do it? Maybe. But that comes down to the soldier team being able to potentially tank with Professor X, knocking him to this, where he's a 20 defense, and then hoping that the 10 on a 20 from the foot elites will knock him down the rest of his dial. Now, they'll get three chances, probably four, at the with a prob to roll the 10, and in which case, he's pretty much dead. But then the soldier foot elite team has to be able to deal with the Al Jordan. You know, there's a couple of lines of play for Vulture where he doesn't even equip the Awk Arms turn one, and just double barriers, and then does his absolute best to try to survive. Because that comes down to a situation where the foot elite team, specifically the one that PJ's been playing, can just be cleaned up without without needing the Awk Arms. Now, the Awk Arms certainly help, but if it can survive that turn one arms onslaught, and you know what? She is not in there as Samantha Wilson. She is in there as Captain America. So if the soldier team at Nationals comes in and can't survive the turn one, Vulture can go 13-14 attack with 6 damage and KO the foot elites. So boom, 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 then KO Captain America, and then knock Phil, you know, knock Phil to his stop click, and then potentially Al Jordan or some ID card can finish up Phil from there. And then there's just a mayor of droids and suited henchmen left. So the soldier team has to have a plan to hit 20s and 21s with the tank and then get behind the wall and launch it. Most probably mind control Professor X. But that soldier team in and of itself is squishy. But it's probably one of the few teams that can get behind the barrier and bring out Vulture to start getting some shots on him. So, that was about a 45-minute lesson on Vulture. I want to talk a little bit about Pogs today. And so this is one of the things that Alex on our team loves to play Pogs. But there's a couple of concepts that I want to talk about with Pog teams. And unfortunately, like the Penguin is going away soon. But these concepts, I think, I want to say, come into play regardless of, you know, specifically Isaac or specifically the Penguin or, you know, Stegron, that sort of thing. So let's just pull some of these guys up and talk about that. So, Nivel, what was it? Devil Dinosaur is another one that's getting ready to retire. So the important concept is, and this one maybe seem first one to talk about, is to pick a good POG generator. Is the POG generator too pricey? Is the POG generator cheap? Does the POG generator add other things to your team? That really comes into play on whether or not to include the POG generator on your team or to play a POG team. So that's why things like Devil Dinosaur and Stegron, I don't think we'll see a lot of play. And I don't think Devil Dinosaur saw much play throughout his tenure because they were just too many points for what they did. To whereas you look at Isaac, who's already seeing play, and the Penguin, who saw play, won Canadian Nationals, the Rock Canadian Nationals. Got second place at the Rock World Championships. And it does a really good job because they're low points. They provide other value to the team, right? Penguin provides defend, his stealth, a source of Batman enemy for other tricks. Isaac's hardy. He's got the good stop click. He's got super senses. He's got perplex. He's got a full map reach outwit. He turns into an attacker. Now, Devil Dinosaur does that sort of thing, but he's twice as many points as Isaac. And then, so that comes down to you need every available point on your team to be the most effective. So that's when you look at, like, what is a good... what is a good team to include with Pogs? So that comes down to a minimal part of your team should be the Pog generator and this Pog generator support. So that's almost like an engine in and of itself. So in the simplest form, and I'm just going to talk about Tom Kerr's second place Rock Cup team, Rock World Championship team, and talk about how that team has two separate parts to it. And this is what I want to talk about with managing a POG team. Now, he did have the Batgirl trick on his team with the title character. That doesn't currently work, but it did at the time. So... we'll talk about that a little bit. Let me get the rest of his team put in here. Green Arrow, and then Joker at 50. So this team happened to be able to turn out to be a theme team, which worked out really well for it. And it had the seals and all that kind of cool stuff. But the POG generation portion of his team was only 65 points. So he was able to send out shock troopers of POGs, while the rest of the team, Batgirl can call in IDs, Batgirl's perplexes, Batgirl probs, Green Arrow shoots, Joker is annoying, and Joker calls out IDs. He wasn't spending a lot of points here to feed the POG engine. Now, it comes down to some of these other teams. Like, if you take off Batgirl and put on Harley, to some extent, they're investing a lot of points into the POG engine. And I don't think that that makes the team overall as successful, because you're spending a lot of points on POGs, or the supporting the POG engine. The POG engine needs to be probably a third or less of your team. And in the example of Isaac, he's just good by himself on any team and doesn't require a lot of support. So that's a really great thing for him, in that he doesn't require any other support. To whereas you can invest more support in the Penguin engine, but you don't have to. To whereas like Devil Dinosaur requires a ton of answers. Right, because his POGs aren't that great by themselves. So they require some more support as far as perplexing and enhancement or whatever to make them more effective. To whereas I think the Penguin POGs are just better, and the Isaac POGs are just better. So that comes down to, do I think that Stegron will see play? Well, Stegron already has seen a little bit of play, but his POGs just don't have enough oomph for the point value that comes out. You're seeing a 9 attack, a 9 attack, and then 110 attack. So for 75 points, you're just not getting that much value from your dial. Stegron is 75 points and also doesn't have Indomitable. Now, the Penguin doesn't have Indomitable or Willpower, but he's also a 35-point discount. So you're basically getting the other Penguin and the Penguin for less points than you get a Stegron, who can't generate POGs as quickly than the Penguin, because you can potentially even fit a leadership like a Prez Rickard onto the Penguin team for the same point. So you could have Penguin Prez Rickard for the same cost as a Stegron and potentially have your POGs go more turns and your POG generator go more turns, as opposed to just Stegron by himself. So that's kind of the thought process. There's really not a lot of positioning to think about. Other than on the map, if you think about this working out as you have your POG engine and your POG, not POG engine, the rest of the team doing their thing out on the map, whether that's attacking, calling out IDs, being a general annoyance, whatever that may be. So, I don't know, we'll see if we get more POGs in the future. I think we're getting a couple of POG generators in the new set, the Black Panther set. I think I would really want to bring back in the POG discussion in our post-retirement discussion next month. But those are some tips and tricks that we found for running a POG team. So there's a couple other things I wanted to talk about on Vulture. I realize I just missed over it on my notes to round out today's class. So we talked about Uni Lockjaw. We talked about the barrier team. We talked about full Uni. So I was able to beat a full Uni with Vulture, but he didn't destroy my canister. The second time I played him, he got to go first, destroyed my canister, first flurry on, and he rolled shape change. Full point Black Panther, or even 150 Panther, that's a themed, has a good chance because he has the range, and the ability to go out and shoot the gas and pick up his Mandarin ring for shape change so that he can always, so that he can get his rollouts. So Black Panther should be, I think, generally played with the Black Panther map bonus. So he'll have shape change, super senses twice, and imperv. Now, if he misses imperv, he'll take three, one, two, three, and then he'll get shape change and super senses again. If he misses that, he'll take, if he goes there, he'll take four. One, two, three, four. Same thing. He'll have shape change and super senses again. But Black Panther's a little bit more risky play. You've got six rollouts to hit, and you just need to be able to hit one of them. So that's a Black Panther Lockjaw team. Something else that I think is pretty neat is just the Don't Die team. So that comes into your Daredevil, your Haha Joker, your Ironheart. With the tray lane, even just a lot of things where you're able to just withstand a lot of attacks without dying. And it's certainly a neat one that I like. And this was played out in Arizona, was the full point Black Panther with the corrupt cop. And this is a team that comes out past retirement. Because Corrupt Cop was in, yeah, Harley Quinn. So Vulture can't necessarily kill anything on this team. Because if the Corrupt Cop goes out and harasses and starts attacking, sure, you can keep it off the board. But Black Panther also needs to be able to heal himself up a little bit, because if they can get the zombie warriors out, then that's a bad day for Black Panther. But they're not getting him there without getting through a Mandarin ring shape change and a corrupt cop harassing them. Now that comes into play. You have to win map, but if you do, let's get Black Panther out there and destroy that Joker gas, or the Joker gas canister. So, let's see, did I have another team in my notes? Yeah, no, those were the main teams that I had that were still good against the rest of the field. Well, that will end today's class. Thanks everybody for watching today, and please consider our Patreon if you have interest in attending one of these classes in the future.